Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to start with chapter 2 of the textbook. This chapter is about the axioms of probability. And so in particular, I'm going to give you the definition, the mathematical definition of what we call a probability. You might find the definition kind of strange, but I'm going to show you that in fact the definition makes complete sense and in fact is consistent with our intuition of what a probability should be. And then I'm going to derive a few important properties of probabilities. In particular, I'm going to tell you about symmetric probability space. In this case, you will understand the connection between probability theory and combinatorics. So combinatorics, it's the topic we covered in the previous videos, like in all the videos so far in this playlist. And also I'm going to tell you a little bit about Venn diagrams and how we can use Venn diagrams to derive more properties about probabilities. And so that you understand the use of a Venn diagram, I'm going to show you as an illustration how you can use Venn diagrams to prove something called the inclusion-exclusion identity. So first, so that you understand the connection with real world, I'm going to go back with our example, the example we used in the first video of this playlist of rolling two dice. So if you remember, one basic question you can have in probability theory is you take two dice, two fair dice, let's say you roll the two dice, and a question can be, what is the probability that the sum of the two dice is equal to 7? Okay, that's one example. So behind this process of rolling two dice and looking at the probability that the sum is equal to 7, there is some kind of mathematical structure behind this particular case, but that is common across the field of probability theory. And to explain this mathematical structure, I'm going to introduce a few definitions. So the first important concept is the concept of experiment. So each time in probability theory, you start with an experiment. So an example of experiment that we just saw is rolling two dice. Okay, rolling two dice is an example of experiment. And of course, there are other examples of experiments. So for instance, you can flip a coin. Flip a fair coin is another example of experiment. Or the third one can be choosing 5 cards at random from an ordinary deck of 52 cards. So these are examples of experiments. From like behind each experiment, something attached to each experiment is something that we call the sample space. And the sample space is basically the set of all the possible outcomes. Okay, so each time you have an experiment, then you can, behind this, you have something called sample space. So I'm going to call it omega. That's the way we call it typically, at least at the broad level, and I prefer to keep this notation. And so this one is going to be the set of all the possible outcomes. So all possible outcomes of your experiment. So for instance, going back to the example of rolling two dice, then this set is going to be a set with 36 possible elements that corresponds to 36 possible outcomes that are 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, and so on up to a 6. That's all the possible outcomes you can get after you roll your two dice. Then, now that you have this set, so maybe what I should precise quickly is that in case you roll two dice, it's easy to write the set omega. Sometimes the set omega can be pretty big and it's just impossible to write it because there are too many elements in this set, but you have at least an idea of what is this set. It's possible also that if you go to a much more complicated experiment where the number of outcomes can be infinite and countable, that this set is pretty difficult to write or even conceptualize, but it's important at least to have in mind that behind each experiment there is such a set, and it's important in fact to have this in mind to be able to after define this notion of probability. Okay, so then Once you have this set, what you can do is look at all the possible subsets of this set omega, and all those subsets are called events. So that's another technical term in the field of probability theory. So after, you can look at events. And events are basically all the possible subsets of omega. So strictly speaking, in the field of modern probability theory, so that's more probability theory at the grad level, it's not enough to look at any subset of omega. You need some restriction to have a good definition of events. But at the undergrad level, that's okay to just stick to this definition. That's not going to be a problem to assume that any subset of omega is an event. So here, you have to keep in mind like three terms that we define. So the notion of experiment is important. Here, the example is rolling two dice. Then notion of sample space. In this case, that's all the possible outcomes of the two dice. It's going to be a set with 36 possible elements. And events, all the possible subsets of omega, that's a third important term in probability theory. And so, for instance, an example of event in the case of rolling two dice would be that the sum is equal to 7. Okay, that's an example of event. And indeed, if you look at this slide, for instance, you see that the event that you get a 7, that the sum is equal to 7, is going to be a set A that is equal to the set of outcomes 1, 6, 2, 5, 3, 4, 4, 3, 5, 2, 6, 1. Indeed, you see that this set A is a subset of our sample space omega. So now that we know what an event is, we can define the notion of probability, so definition. So a probability from a mathematical point of view is going to be the following object. So probability is going to be any function that we typically call P, defined on the set of all the possible events and with value in the interval 0, 1. Such that, well, P has to satisfy two properties or axioms to indeed be a probability. But before I tell you about those axioms, let me tell you a little bit about this set here. So P is a function, and I'm sure you know what a function is in mathematics, but typically functions are defined on a set, and you look at the function at an element of this set. Here, the set we are looking at is not a set of elements, it's a collection of subsets of omega, that's the set of all possible events. So have in mind that you don't look at the probability of an element, you don't look at the function at one element, you look at the function of a subset of this set. So that's something slightly more theoretical than typical functions we see in general in mathematics. And so to give you an example, for instance, if again you assume that your experiment is rolling two dice, then you can indeed look at the probability of having a double six, for instance, so the probability of one specific outcome in omega, but you can look at probabilities of something more complicated, like the probability that the sum is equal to 7. In which case, instead of looking at the function at a point in your set omega, you look at the function of a subset of omega. That's going to be the probability of having 1, 6, or 2, 5, or 3, 4, and so on. So, first observation, have in mind that a probability is a function defined on a collection of subsets. So that's an object that is more theoretical than typical function you saw before. Now, the first axiom we need to have a probability is the fact that P of omega should be equal to 1. So this one makes sense. This means that each time you have an experiment, and so a sample space attached to this experiment, then one of the outcomes must occur, and that's why we have this condition. It says that Again, if you roll two dice, the probability of having 1-2 or 1-3 or 1-4 or 1-5 and so on, and you go across all the 36 possible outcomes up to a double 6, then the probability of that happening should be equal to 1. Because again, each time you roll your two dice, one of the 36 outcomes should surely occur. So that's what this first condition says. That's not surprising. Now, second condition is called sigma additivity. So this one is a little bit more tricky. Sigma additivity. And this one says that each time you take a collection of events that are mutually exclusive, so let's say if AI intersection AJ is equal to the empty set for all I different ranges. So what I'm doing here is that I'm taking a collection of events that I'm calling AI, and I assume that each time I take two events in this collection of events, then those two events are incompatible, or we say mutually exclusive. That means that their intersection is equal to the empty set. So that means also that those two events cannot occur simultaneously. Then if you take such a collection, then what we must have is that the probability of the union for I equals, so I'm going to write 1 to infinity, because potentially, I mean, that's true for if you look at an infinite collection of events, that's the way a probability is defined. And then if you look at an infinite union of events like that, then that must be equal to the infinite sum for I equals 1 to infinity of the probability of AI. So that's the second axiom we need to have a probability. So now I'm going to explain why this makes sense again. So here I'm taking infinite collection of events, because potentially your set omega can be infinite. But of course it's true also if you look at a finite union and finite sum. So let's look at the finite case, for instance. Again, if you roll two dice, what this tells you, for instance, is that the probability, because the event that you get a 7 is equal to the union of the outcomes 1-6, 2-5, 3-4, and so on up to 6-1. And because those outcomes are in fact mutually exclusive, they satisfy this condition, you cannot get 1-6 and 2-5 at the same time, then what this condition is going to tell you is that the probability that the sum is equal to 7 is equal to the probability of having 1-6 plus the probability of having 2-5 plus the probability of having 3-4 and so on. Okay? So that's exactly what it says, and again, this second condition, even if it looks mathematically complicated, that's indeed a property that is expected. Like intuitively, we want a probability to satisfy this axiom. Now, why choosing those two axioms to define a probability? Because there are many other properties that a probability can satisfy, so why choosing just those two ones to define the notion of probability? Well, that's because from 1 and 2, you can in fact deduce anything you wish that a probability can satisfy. So for instance, from those two conditions, you can prove that the probability of the empty set is equal to 0. You can also prove that the probability of the complement of an event is equal to 1 minus the probability of this event, which says that the probability that something does not occur is equal to 1 minus the probability that it occurs, and a bunch of other properties. So keep in mind that from those two ones, all the properties that intuitively should be true for this function P can be, like all those properties can be deduced from just those two axioms. That's why we use them to define a probability. So now for the rest of this video, keep in mind all this pattern. So that's summarized here in the slide. each time you deal with a probability problem, you start with an experiment, like rolling two dice. Then behind this experiment, there is something called a sample space that corresponds to the set of all possible outcomes. Then events are defined as all the possible subsets of omega, and a probability can be any function that is defined on this set of events, meaning that it makes sense to look at the probability of an event. And so that P is indeed a probability, you need two axioms. First, the probability of omega is equal to 1, and second, you have this sigma additivity properly for this function P. So now let's talk about symmetric probability spaces, and I'm going to define what I mean by that. So symmetric, that's a particular case, symmetric probability spaces. So this is when you deal with an experiment where the total number of outcomes is finite. So that means the set omega is finite. And we also assume that all the outcomes are equally likely. So we have omega finite and outcomes equally likely. So an example of symmetric probability space is when, again, going back to our example of the two dice, if you roll two dice, then if the dice are not fair, then the probability of all the outcomes are not going to be the same. So your function P defined on your set omega is not going to be symmetric. But if you assume that the dice are fair, then in this case, that means that each of the six possible values for each of the two dice are going to be equally likely, in which case we end up with 36 outcomes that have exactly the same probability. So let me write this example. Rolling two fair dice. And so you see here, for instance, that if the dice are not fair, then your function P is going to be different than if you assume that the two dice are fair. And so that means that you don't have uniqueness of probability, even if you have a fixed set omega with some fixed experiment, then there are many possible choices for your function P to be a probability. But if you assume, again, the two axioms of a probability. So the first one, again, is the fact that P of omega is equal to 1. And the second one is just the one called sigma additivity that says that the probability of a union of events is equal to the sum of their probabilities if they are mutually exclusive. So if you assume those two axioms plus the fact that the outcomes are equally likely, then that's going to define a unique function P that satisfies those three conditions on your set omega. And in this case, it turns out that you can prove that computing the probability of an event is exactly the same as reduces basically to a combinatorial problem. So combinatorial analysis is what we saw in the previous video, that's those counting rules. And so let me show you this. So let's focus, for instance, again, on this case of rolling two fair dice. In this case, you are going to have that P of 1-1 is equal to P of 1-2 and so on up to P of 6-6. So all the 36 outcomes are equally likely. That's exactly what this means. Now, if you have this condition plus sigma additivity plus this fact, then that means that your function P is uniquely defined in the sense that for all subsets A of omega, all events A, P of A is uniquely defined by those three conditions. And you kind of guess the answer, but I'm going to show you how we can indeed use those three conditions to get probabilities of specific events in the case of rolling two fair dice. So the first thing to observe is that omega can be written as union of its singleton. Okay, omega is exactly 1, 1, union 1, 2, union 1, 3, and so on up to 6, 6. All those outcomes are mutually exclusive, and so you can use sigma DTBD and then write that P of omega should be equal to P of 1, 1 plus P of 1, 2, and so on up to P of 6, 6. So, and so on plus P of 6, 6. But because you assume that the outcomes are equally likely, that means that you have a sum here of 36 numbers that are equal. Okay, so in general, this sum is just equal to 36 times P of something I'm going to call little omega. Little omega can be anything in capital omega. But using now the first axiom of a probability, we know that P of omega is equal to 1. And so that means that this number here should be equal to 1. From this, you clearly deduce that the probability of each particular outcome is going to be equal to 1 over 36. So, of course, we have some intuition that yes, that should be true, but that's only an intuition. Now you have an actual proof, okay? Using sigma DTBD, you get this equation here. Now using the fact that all the outcomes are equally likely, you get the second equation. And using the first axiom here, you get this third equation. And from that, you deduce that P of omega, or let me erase and write that at the top here. So from this, you deduce that P of omega is equal to 1 over 36 for all little omega in capital omega. Those little omegas are basically all possible of the 36 outcomes of the two dice. So from this, we conclude that P of omega is equal to 1 over 36. So that gives you the specific value of each outcome, that gives you a proof of like specific value of each of the outcomes for this experiment. Now, it turns out that P is not just defined on the set of outcomes, it's defined on the set of events that are all the possible subsets of omega. And so now, another question is, how can we deduce from this property the probability of particular events? And so let's look at, again, the same event that we are looking at from the beginning of this video, the event A that, let's say, the sum is 7. Then in this case, you can look at P of A. And again, using sigma DTBD and also the fact that A is going to be the union of the outcomes 1, 6, 2, 5, and so on, 3, 4, 4, 3, and so on. You can, so combining A is the union of those 6 outcomes and sigma DTBD, you get that this probability should be equal to probability of 1, 6, plus probability of 2, 5, and so on, up to probability of 6, 1. But we know that for each of those specific outcomes, the probability is 1 over 36, and you have 6 of those outcomes, and so eventually you get 6 over 36. Okay, so again, we knew that already, like we know how to get this result intuitively, but now you have an actual proof in this particular case. But now you see that this 6 over 36 comes from the fact that in this event A, there are 6 possible outcomes, there are 6 different outcomes. And the 36 comes from the fact that there is a total of 36 possible outcomes in our set omega. And so from this, we can deduce that in general, at least for this event, okay, we have that this probability is equal to this fraction, which is also the cardinal of A divided by the cardinal of omega. So cardinal here is just the function that counts the number of elements in a set. And so what we were able to prove in this particular case of rolling two fair dice is the fact that the probability of the probability that the sum is 7 is indeed equal to the number of outcomes such that the sum is 7 divided by the total number of outcomes. Now, reproducing exactly this proof, it's slightly more theoretical, but you can prove in general that each time you have a symmetric probability space, meaning that the state space omega is finite and all the outcomes are equally likely, then for all possible subsets A of omega that we call events, so for all event A, we are going to have that P of A is equal to the number of outcomes in A divided by the number of outcomes in omega. So indeed, this shows that in order to compute a probability, in the case of symmetric probability space, what we need to do is just count number of outcomes. And so the problem is reduced to a problem in combinatorial analysis. Now, to conclude this video, let me tell you a little bit about Venn diagrams and how we can use Venn diagrams to derive a bunch of interesting properties about probabilities. So now I should precise also that everything I'm going to tell you about for at the end of this video is not just true for symmetric probability spaces. Now we are back to the general case. Everything I'm going to tell you about is true in general for any probabilities on any possible sample space. So what the concept we want to use is called Venn diagram. And so basically a Venn diagram is just a picture or a diagram of sets showing also the kind of logical relationship among those sets. And in our case of probability theory, the set we are going to start with is the set omega, the set of all the possible outcomes called the sample space. And the subsets of omega we are going to look at are particular events of interest. So, for instance, a Venn diagram can look like this. So you have, let's say, a big rectangle like that corresponding to the set omega. And then you can have events here. So let me take three events that I'm going to call A1, A2, A3. And so a priori, those sets overlap. So that's a general picture of using a Venn diagram of three subsets of omega. So now it turns out that you can use this type of picture along with tally marks to find probabilities of not just particular events, but maybe union of events. And that's what I'm going to do to illustrate the use of a Venn diagram. Using this, you can deduce a lot of properties. I'm not going to prove everything. And in fact, you have infinitely many possible properties, so I cannot prove everything. But I'm going to focus on one particular case of interest in practice as an illustration of the use of a Venn diagram called the inclusion-exclusion identity. So example of application, it's inclusion-exclusion identity. Inclusion-exclusion identity. And this is basically a formula about probabilities that tells you about the probability of a union. So we want to look at the probability of the union of those three events. And the motivation here comes from the fact that it turns out that very often in practice, if you have natural events, L1, L2, L3, it's easier to compute the probability of these events, or the probability of intersection of any two or any three events, than computing the probability of the union. Probability of unions are typically a little bit more difficult to find, and so that's why we have this trick here called the inclusion-exclusion identity that allows you to write a probability of a union using only probabilities of intersection. And the way you can prove that it's by using just this picture, Venn diagram, and tally marks. So let me show you how it works. In this case, we want to compute the probability of the event A1, union A2, union A3. So now what you want to do first is you want at least to count all the outcomes that are only in A1, only in A2, or only in A3. And so the best way to do that is just to add up P of A1 plus P of A2 plus P of A3. Now, if you do this, it turns out that you don't get the answer, but again, using Venn diagrams with tally marks, we are going to be able to identify where is the problem and correct it. And after a few steps, we are going to be able to express the probability of this union using only probability of those events, probability of intersection of any two events, and probability of the intersection of all three events. So step one, you just said that this is equal to P of A1 plus P of A2 plus P of A3. Now, to visualize this sum of probabilities on the Venn diagram, what I'm going to do is put tally marks in all the subsets that are subsets of A1, and same for A2 and same for A3. And so eventually, so for A1, we have tally marks here, here, and here, and here. That's the four subsets that are subsets of A1. Then same for A2. So we have one tally mark here, one here, one here, one here. And then for S3, we are going to have one tally mark here, 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 and here. And so now we see that this sum counts, in fact, each outcome in A1, A2, or S3 only once if those outcomes are in only one of those three subsets, but you overestimate the probability because of those multiple tally marks in the intersection. So now, to compensate, it seems that, well, you need to remove at least one tally mark from each of those three sets here, and for that, you are just going to subtract by the probability of intersection of any two of those three events. And so eventually, you get, after a minus P of A1 intersection A2, minus P of A1 intersection S3, minus P of A2 intersection S3. Now, if you look at minus P of A1 intersection A2, that's the same as removing one tally mark from each of the subsets on the diagram that corresponds to A1 intersection A2. So A1 intersection A2 is this little set here, so I need to remove one tally mark here and another one here. Okay, then I'm looking after at minus P of A1 intersection F3. So for that, I'm going to remove things in this intersection here. I need to remove one tally mark in each of the two subsets. Then finally, minus P of A2 intersection S3. A2 intersection S3 is this subset, so I need to remove one tally mark here and one tally mark there. Okay, and so now I end up with exactly one tally mark everywhere I want, except in the middle here. So this first term overestimates this probability, but now that I remove that, I underestimate the probability of the union. Okay? And so now, last step, I need to add one tally mark here to make sure that we indeed count once, exactly once, all the outcomes in the union of the three events. And for that, I just add plus P of A1 intersection A2 intersection S3. And so now, going back to the Venn diagram, by adding that, I need to add one tally mark in the subset corresponding to the intersection of all three. So I add one here. And now we are good. Now you see that indeed we count each outcome in the union exactly once. Okay, so that's not a completely rigorous proof, but I think you are convinced that this should work. And here we only use basic properties of probability to be able to end up with such expression. So this equation here is called the inclusion-exclusion identity. I show you how it works in the particular case of three events, but you have a more general formula for n events. And so you notice the pattern that here you are going to start with adding numbers. So you have pluses here. Then you are going to subtract probabilities. So you have minuses here. And then you are again going to add at the end in case of three events. So that explains the name of this identity that's called inclusion-exclusion, because at step one we include those events, then we are going to compensate. We need to exclude intersection of any two events, and then we need to again include, and so on. In case you have n events, you have a natural generalization of that, where you are going to again start with a plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, and so on. And then you see that at this line, you are going to look at only one event. Then, second line, we are going to remove intersection of two events. And then third line, you are going to add probabilities of intersection of three events. Again, in general, if you have n events, you are going to have at the third line remove probabilities of intersection of four events, and then add probabilities of intersection of five events, and so on. So, looking at this slide, you have a general formula for the inclusion-exclusion identity that tells you about the probability of a union of events. So, in general, we want to look at the probability of a union of n events, A1 union A2 up to union AN. Remember that if those events are mutually exclusive, then the second axiom of a probability just tells you that the probability of the union is equal to the sum of the probabilities. That's true when you deal with disjoint subset or mutually exclusive events, but when those events overlap, things are more difficult, and that's at the bottom right, you have the general formula that tells you that the probability of the union is equal to the sum for k equals 1 to n of negative 1 at the power k plus 1. So this term is going to alternate starting with a plus and then a minus and then a plus and then a minus and so on. So again, that's what I explained on the board, that's this inclusion-exclusion principle. You include and then exclude and then include again and so on. And then what we are going to include or exclude are sums of probabilities of intersection of events. And this last sum on the right is the sum over all the possible choices of k events from our set of n events. And to conclude, I want to point out that even if I use this idea of Venn diagram along with those tally marks to show you how to prove the inclusion-exclusion identity in the case of three events, in fact, this approach or this technique of combination of Venn diagram and tally marks is not restricted to just this case. Obviously, you can use this technique to re-express the probability of any event using probabilities of other events. And obviously, in practice, you want to use that when you have to compute the probability of a complicated event for which the probability is not clear, and you are able, using this Venn diagram, to re-express this probability using other probabilities that are much easier to compute.